like to go on to the last short session of this five-day enterprise, which we call the Network of Networks, and just start with a few comments and responses to some of the things that were raised in the discussions today. The idea of a network and why a network of networks. Actually, I think we all realize there's nothing new or original about this idea. In fact, though we think of this as the first really networked generations in the network society, networks are nothing new at all. They go back to the very origins of human civilization. Only thing is the size and scale, magnitude and speed and complexity of the networks has grown enormously. I mean, our whole human civilization is built on networks. It started with the small network of the family or the village or the small rural community, or then the regional kingdom, and then the urban towns, and then it started with trade and commerce and eventually built up into kingdoms and empires. And the only thing that's happened is we've gone global. We've reached the edges of the universe, the human universe here, and the speed has increased so much, the complexity has increased so much. So there's nothing new about talking about networks. But I think there were a couple of important points that were raised in the discussion in the last few hours. One of them was by Phoebe saying that she thinks we should develop clear structure for our partnerships in future. And there was another one by Azita. I think she made some very important comments about, what is our goal? Are we just going to be talking and thinking ideas? Are we really going to become action oriented? And what does this network of networks really mean? What do we want to do? Where do we want to end up? What do we want to be known for? And I think these are really very important strategic issues. And I don't pretend that we have a clear consensus on what that is. But I'd like to share with you my thoughts about what we're trying to do, what I think we're trying to do at this time. For a long time, the Academy, when we think of a network of networks, I'm not really thinking about how do we contact thousands of organizations all over the world. I'm wondering, can we tap even 10% of the richness of our own members? Because each one of our members is a network connected to so many networks, an intellectual network, a social network, an occupational network. And I think I'm very well aware of the fact that we have tapped a very small part of that. In some cases, it's easier to go out and contact other partner organizations. Just imagine what we can do if one more member comes and looks at all the networks. I was inspired and I learned a lot working with Evo over the last 15 years, particularly in 2010 and 11 and 12, because Evo is a living network. The first thing he did when he became president was he thought, which are all the organizations that I'm associated with? And can I forge a relationship with WAS? He got us with the European Leadership Network. He got us with the Club of Rome, though we had previous associations. And on and on and on. Who are the people I know? And he started finding fellows. He recruited more. He set the record for nominating more fellows to the Academy than anyone else, which is one of the reasons why we're a little top heavy in Southeast Europe, because his connections were so thick there, and we've still not been able to fully compensate. But I think the spirit with which he did it was absolutely marvelous. And he did something else too. I learned something else invaluable from him, that the goal of an organization should not be to define its uniqueness and defend itself and prove and compete with everybody else. The real strength of an organization is its capacity to link with and multiply the value of other organizations. And that's the approach we've been taking the last 8 years, 8-9 years, is to see when in our global leadership project, we reached a level of 70 partnering organizations in the global leadership project, including, I think the count was more than 10 UN organizations. And we didn't do that by going out and signing up and asking them to do something for us. We did it by saying, look, we have a platform here. We have an opportunity here. Is there a way that you can benefit from that? We invited IAP, the Inter-Academy Partners, in and said, look, we're a partner with you. We've been a member of IAP for 5 years, but we've never been able to do anything with them. You're doing some wonderful things that are related to global leadership. Come and talk about them here. And now we've got an ongoing relationship with IAP. They're participating in our human security project. They're very enthusiastic about it. They're sending it out to all their Academy members. So imagine, let alone the networks in the world and reaching everybody, imagine if each of us can open up our networks and think about who are the people we know, who are the fellows who we should be bringing in, where are the people, the connections we have. Even if we get a small part of that, we'll be able to multiply our impact 100 times what it is today. That's the wealth of this organization. It's not, as much as I would love to have an office in Athens, as Phoebe has suggested, or in somewhere else in Greece. It's not our physical premises. It's not the money in the bank, surely. It's not that's our asset. Our asset is the minds of our members and the relationships and trustworthiness and credibility and aspiration of our members. And I think we're still at just scratching the surface. And that's one of the reasons that I don't think at this point we should say, look, we've got this global referendum project is enough. If we live and see that through, we can all consider ourselves a life fulfillment. We don't need to do anything else. And I hope we do that. But I don't think it should be an either or. Because for the simple reason, yes, if all the work in the Academy is to be done by a small group of officers or even a board of trustees, for sure, we cannot handle more than one or two projects at a time. We already see that we get run down by the pressure of one or two projects or events. But imagine if we can put in place and energize more and more of our member networks. And these projects, like the one that Julien and Frank were talking about, this doesn't have to go through the Board of Trustees at WASC. We can certainly help, and our whole membership can help. Why shouldn't we have 5, 10, 15, 20 engines, all working along according to a common perspective? And that's why I started this morning, or was earlier today, by talking about that core identity we have, which is really a perspective. And why shouldn't we be running 5, 10 projects with our resource, our real capital resource, which is our people? And for that, we need to know what you're interested in. We know what will energize you the way this transformation of change in networks has energized Frank and Julien. And we saw that in the meetings. In December, we sent out a mail to all our fellows in saying, we're going to have this General Assembly and conference, and we are inviting proposals. We got 35 proposals from members, out of hundreds and hundreds of active members. And out of those, we chose and we finally came up with 21 sessions. And a number of those sessions, as we've been hearing about today, some of them were directly linked to the Global Leadership Project because we had unanswered questions that we still wanted to answer. And so we took advantage of having all our fellows coming together to try to complete some loose ends before we go to a final report to the UN. Can't say our time has run out. We want to be sure we've got the best answers and we got some great impact input on that. We've got the World University Consortium project now, maybe really taking off, I think, from the sessions we've had here and the board meeting we had, which Ramus talked about. But why shouldn't we have 5 or 10 engines driven by the rich capacities, intellectual capacities we have? And then what's the type of organization we need to do that, to keep it, to support it? To support the coordination, to keep the coherence and integrity of it, we have to invent it as we go along. But part of that, I love what we heard from Michael Mellor today, because the genius, he told you at the end, he confessed the whole secret of this project, which, by the way, they've got $9 million now. They have only 12 people. 12 people. And they got $9 million, $3 million from the government and then $6 million from foundations they got. How could they do all of this with 12 people? Because it's not 12 people. They've got this scientific network. He said 65 scientists. It's not 65 scientists. It's probably 65 organizations headed by, or where departments are headed by science. It's a huge web of relations. And then he's got his diplomacy group or his policy making group. He said that 12 UN agencies and so many other social scientists and so much else. It's a network. The structure is a network. And it's not how many people you have on your payroll. It's not how many people you have in your building. It's how well we can tap the resources of the world, not for ourselves, but to meet the needs and help answer the questions that are out there. So I'm trying to say, I don't have the answer to Azita's really good questions about how many projects we should handle. Certainly, I'd love to take some of these projects down to actual implementation. As a business consultant, I like to see results, measurable results on the ground. But I think that may not be all we are. And we'll have to see as we go along how much we are, and a lot of it's going to depend on you, the decisions you make. So what we've tried to announce with this GA is we're open for business. If you have a program that really fits in to the central core perspective of the academy, and if there's something we can do to help you move that, that's going to also feed in to the general momentum of what we have, we're going to try to do that. If it's going to all be left to a board of trustees or a few officers and the handful of people we have as our staff, of course, we will not be able to do that. I think the potential is so rich, I'd rather shoot for the moon and let's see how far we get rather than be too modest in our aspirations at this point. So we're pretty much to the end of the conference, but if anybody has, I would just like to thank you all for coming and being such rich participants in this. And it's just such a joy to be working in this environment with our fellows, and look forward to meeting you all again very soon. Bye now.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you. Bye.
It was a great event.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Nice to stay safe.
All the best.
Support the group.
Congratulations to all of us, team.
Congratulations. It was very good.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Goodness be to everybody.